Today we will discuss about microbiological criteria and sampling guidelines. It is very important to know the microbiological criteria. It is also important to know why it is so important for getting idea about the microbiological quality of any food item or any dairy product. And at the same time, it is also important to know about the sampling procedures. How you can go for sampling processes for different product, because all products have different characteristic, different nature. So accordingly, you have to decide and accordingly, you have to choose a particular type of sampling method. Now, microbiological criteria. Microbiological criteria defines the acceptability of a product or a food lot based on the absence or presence or number of microorganisms, including parasite and or quality of their toxins, metabolites per unit of mass, volume, area, or lot. What do you mean by this sentence? On what basis you can say that your product is microbiologically safe or it is not good for human consumption? So sometimes you have to go for knowing the total bacterial count. In some cases, you have to check particular type of about the presence or absence of some kind of pathogenic microorganisms like Salmonella, Shigella, Staphylococcus aureus, Listeria monocytogenes, and Yersinia enterocolitica. Or sometimes you have to check the metabolites produced by different kind of microorganisms, which are responsible for creating different kind of abnormality in human being. So it is very important to check all these things during microbiological analysis. And it is very important to decide about the wholesomeness, quality status, or you can say the microbiological quality of that particular product. Now, microbiological criteria may be used to define the acceptability of a processed product or food lot. So just by getting idea about the microbiological population or microbial number or type of microorganism, your food item, or just by having idea about different metabolites, you can say that whatever processes you have chosen during manufacturing of a particular product is good or not good. Whatever product you have manufactured, it is good for human consumption or not. And your whole lot produce is good for marketing purpose or good for human consumption or not. At the same time, the criteria could be the absence, presence, or number of microorganisms, or the quality of their toxins, metabolites in sample. So these things reflect the overall quality of a product. Now, microbiological criteria may be used either by an individual establishment or to set national baseline. So nowadays, you have already studied about FASAI, which is very much required by different manufacturers. And they have set a national baseline for any organization or any manufacturing unit. Sometimes some factories were responsible for producing a typical type of product. They are fixing their own standard and they are maintaining the guidelines they have fixed for producing that particular type of product. Now, any microbiological criteria for food should have following information: a statement of microorganisms and toxins of concern, then lab methods for their detection and quantification, sampling plan, number of samples required to confirm of these limits, and microbiological limits. So these five are very important whenever you are talking about the microbiological criteria. A clear-cut indication about different kind of microorganisms, its number, or different kind of toxic substance they are liberating, it is very important to have idea about that. at the same time, what method you have to perform for detecting or you can say quantification of a particular type of microorganism is also very important, because a number of methods given by different laboratories or research laboratories or educational institutions or well-established regulatory bodies, they have given different kind of methods. So whatever method prescribed by FSSAI or different that level of legal body, you have to follow the guidelines given by them, and the same method you have to use for detection as well as quantification of different kind of microorganisms. As all of you know that we are giving different kind of manufacturing treatment to different dairy product, so automatically sampling plan is very important. So what amount of sample is required for which product or a particular type of product, you have to have idea about that, and how you can take that sample, it is also very important. The number of samples required to conform to these limits is very important. How many samples are required from a particular lot of a particular type of product, and at the same time it is also very important to know the microbiological limit. If your product exceeds that limit, automatically you can't send that kind of product to the consumer. You have to give the same information to the manufacturing person for rectifying those problems. So these 5 points are very important as far as the microbiological criteria for food is concerned. Now, something about the microbiological standard. As all of you know, that microbiological standards for different food items have been fixed, where risk assessment has shown that the risk of foodborne illness associated with the consumption of certain food is relatively high, and that a standard could contribute to the management of the probable risk. So all these things are very important. You have to have idea about how you can assess the risk related to a particular type of product, what kind of foodborne problem may arise in that particular product, what type of condition we are giving during the manufacturing. These all are responsible, or these all are dictating that what kind of microorganisms may be present in your final product, and accordingly you have to plan the whole system. Now, the microbiological criteria. A criteria is fixed on which a decision can be made. So first of all, you have to fix a microbiological criteria, and you have to follow those guidelines prescribed under that microbiological criteria. A microbiological criteria will stipulate that a type of microorganism, group of microorganisms, or toxin produced by a microorganism must either be not present at all or be present in only a limited number of samples, or be present at less than a specified number of amount in a given quantity of a food or food ingredient. Nowadays, it is very important. I have already given you a draft issued by this FSSAI. In that, you can see the sampling procedure, a small M and capital M. So just by going through, you can have idea about the sampling plan for different kind of dairy products. And you have to follow those sampling plan for getting idea about the microbiological load of any product. And as per that, you can say that your product is acceptable or it is not acceptable. Now, the microbiological criteria should include the following: a statement describing the identity of a food, a statement of the contaminants of concern, the microorganism or group of microorganisms and toxin, or other agent. Suppose you are manufacturing a very high temperature treated product, automatically the microorganism may present in that is different compared to a fermented product. So one must have complete idea about the manufacturing processes and what type of treatment you are giving, because the different type of product, end product, or toxic substance or the different type of microorganisms varies with the treatment you are giving during processing treatment. The analytical method to be used for detection, enumeration, and quantification of the contaminants of concern. It is very important that what kind of detection process you are using or you are choosing for detecting a particular type of microorganism. If your product is highly heat treated or given different kind of manufacturing treatment during manufacturing operation, automatically in that case, suppose you want to have idea about Yersinia enterocolitica in ice cream. So many processes are given during manufacturing of ice cream. So just after taking samples from market, you have to go for pre-enrichment. Thereafter, you have to go for enrichment process. Thereafter, microbiological screening is required. Selective plating on a particular type of agar recommended for that particular type of pathogens is required. Thereafter, quantification will be done. So these processes you have to follow as per the nature of that particular product. At the same time, sampling plan is very important. I have already discussed about that. The microbiological limits considered appropriate to the food and commensurate with the sampling plan. So the microbiological limit or total bacterial population for different product is directly related to the sampling plan, and it is very important. And the just by going through that draft, you can have idea about the sampling plan also. Now it is very important to know some terms, which is very important. Microbiological standard, mandatory criteria with legal backing. It is very important, and there is legal backing for those standards before fixing. Then microbiological specification, it is also very important. Contractual agreements between the manufacturer and a purchaser to take whether the food are of required quality. So different regulatory bodies or different organizations which are responsible for maintaining quality of different product, they are fixing some kind of microbiological specification, and you have to maintain those specification. At the same time, they are issuing some kind of microbial guidelines, and it is non-mandatory criteria, usually intended as a guide to good manufacturing practices. Then microbiological limits is very important. If your product is crossing that limit, automatically you can't permit that product to sell, and it should not be safe for human consumption. So automatically you have to consider, and you should have idea about these terms before talking about different microbiological standard specification. Now it is very important to have idea about that, why this microbiological analysis of food, why we are doing all these things. You all have idea about the food spoilages, you have idea about the food safety, and just for getting idea about that, you have to perform different kind of microbiological tests. One of the most important reasons for analyzing foods from both the consumer and manufacturer standpoint is to ensure that they are safe. That is most important thing. We have repeatedly explained you that why we are doing this thing, why it is very important to produce good quality food item. Right from beginning, telling you people that when you are taking good quality of raw meal, automatically you can produce a very good quality of final product. Now, a food may be considered to be unsafe because it contains harmful microorganisms. These are the emerging pathogens, Listeria monocytogenes, I have discussed so many times, Salmonella, different species of Salmonella. These are responsible for creating abnormal condition to human being. So automatically, if it is present in your food item, it is unsafe for human consumption. Then food contaminated with pathogenic microorganisms do not look bad, taste bad, or smell bad. Disease that results from contaminated food are of two types. You have already studied about food-borne intoxication and food-borne infection. What is the difference between these two? You all have idea about food intoxication. Whatever number of a particular microorganism is required to produce some kind of toxic substance, that particular food item is already achieved that number. It means the toxic substance or metabolites responsible for creating abnormal condition to human being is already present in your food. And whenever you are ingesting that kind of food, immediately you will show some kind of abnormal symptom. Some kind of abnormality will start in your vomition, loose motion, nausea, red patches on your body, so many things you will observe just after taking that kind of food item. At the same time, foodborne infection, it means a small, you are ingesting a food item having a small number of these pathogenic microorganisms. After attaining certain population or after reaching up to certain level, it will start showing some kind of symptom to your body. It means when you are ingesting a contaminated food, having some kind of a small number of pathogenic microorganisms, and after getting or after proper incubation time, after 24 hours, 10 hours, 15 hours, your body will start showing some kind of abnormal symptom. It is known as foodborne infection. Now the next one is most common symptom associated with foodborne illness is diarrhea. You all have idea about this diarrheal problem. If you are consuming some kind of contaminated food, so diarrhea is one of the most important problem generally associated with these pathogenic microorganisms. Now, necessity of quality control in food testing laboratory. We have already studied so many things. I have just listed out here that a specific activity whose purpose is to monitor a discrete laboratory task to ensure that it meets a predefined criteria. Safety and wholesomeness are the most important attributes of food quality. Then lack of quality as it relates to safety and wholesomeness can result in personal injury, sickness, or death. Sometimes it is causing death also. Foodborne illness is an example of sickness or even death when unsafe food are procured and eaten. The purpose of quality control is to protect the consumer from danger. So all these things are very important, and because of these problems, it is very much important to go for some kind of quality control testing, especially in food industry. Now, scope, to meet about the challenge in the food processing industry, laboratories play a vital role. The scope of testing activities of laboratories encompasses the quality and safety attributes. Agriculture and food products, dairy products, oil seed, oils, spices, and condiments, animal products, plantation products and flavors, functional foods, processed food, and beverages. So these quality control, especially the microbiological quality control system, is highly required for all sort of food items, and different laboratories are there for getting idea about the different level of contaminants. Now the method of microbial analysis, one is quantitative method and second one is qualitative method. What we are doing in qualitative method, we are just getting idea about their presence, whether it is present in your food item or not. And it is in case of Escherichia coli, Salmonella, Staphylococcus aureus, Clostridium perfringens, and Listeria monocytogenes. If it is present in your food item, automatically you have to reject the whole lot. And at the same time, there is some quantitative analysis, that is aerobic, different kind of plate count, yeast and mold count, and total coliform count. So just by having idea about the total count of any food item, you can say that whether your product is safe or not. So field sample collection is there. Then laboratory analysis and reporting is there. Data analysis and interpretation, that what kind of problem may be there during the manufacturing process, you can have idea about on the basis of different kind of software and different kind of statistical data you have. And just by interpreting those information you can have idea about the quality level of a particular type of product, how you can go for field samples. It is mentioned here. So all these things are very important whenever you are talking about microbiological quality control of a particular food item. Now, from suppose you are taking sample from market. So what are the things very important? You have to mention name of the product, then lot number, container size or sizes you have to mention, then product code number is also very important, and labeling information whether your product is fulfilling the quantity or quality parameters mentioned on that label. So you have to go for, and at the same time you have to see the whether your package is broken or not, evidence of rodent or insect infestation and debris. If these things are there, automatically you have to mention all these things in your whatever documentation process you are doing. You have to mention all these things in that. Then so there are some criteria for rejection also: leaking container, then unlabeled, wrongly labeled, mismatched samples are there, then a specimen received in fixative, so insufficient quantity. If sample is insufficient, automatically you have to reject that sample. A specimen unsuitable for request, then prolonged transport, dried specimen, duplicate specimen on the same day for the same test. So all these things are very important. If they are not following these norms, automatically you can reject your sample. Now the microbiological criteria for acceptance or rejection in summarized form, I have given this information in this table. Now it is very important to have idea about the sample size or storage and transport temperature for milk and milk products. So these are the standard. At what temperature you have to transport different products from one place to another place, or from market to laboratory for checking purpose, or for quality evaluation purposes. So simply you have to go through this table that what temperature is required during transportation, and what should be the sample size. So here in this table, reference test procedure for different microbiological parameters proposed in draft standard. It is already given in your e-course. So simply you have to go through and have idea about the different methods, recommended methods given by FSSAI. Now in this table, microbiological criteria for milk and cream is given. What is the standard? What is the maximum permissible limit? That is 50,000. If your product is having more than 50,000 per CFU per gram, automatically you have to reject that sample. So here I have given the meaning of this M and small M and big M. This small A represents an acceptable level, and values above it are marginally acceptable in terms of the sampling plan. And big M, a microbiological criteria which indicate unsatisfactory or potentially hazardous quality, values above M are unacceptable in terms of sampling plan and detection of detection of one or more samples exceeding this level would be cause for rejection of the lot and will attract precaution by the concerned food safety authorities. So you have to remember the maximum level, maximum level for accepting any food item. Here in this table, microbiological criteria for pasteurized butter. So simply you have to go through, you have to remember the standard for different product. If E. coli, a Salmonella, Staphylococcus present in that sample, Listeria monocytogenes, Clostridium perfringens, it should be negative or absent in any food item. So if these products are, these microorganisms are there in the in a product, automatically you have to reject it. Same as here in this table, the microbiological standard of sweetened condensed milk is given. What is the maximum limit for total bacteria, plate count, coliform count, and different type of microorganisms. Same time, dried milk. Now, something about dried milk, because it is very important. as all of you know that we are producing different kind of skim milk powder and whole milk powder. So these are the microorganisms generally found in your dried milk, Bacillus cereus, Clostridium perfringens, Enterobacter, Sacajacki, and Listeria monocytogenes, Salmonella, Shigella, and Staphylococcus. You have to remember the name of all these because these are generally found in different kind of dried product. Spoilage, what is a spoilage? Why it is happening in different product? You have already an idea about that. So this is all about the different kind of microbiological criteria, the different standards for different product. So you have to go through all these slides and you have to remember the maximum limit for total plate count as well as coliform count. Now something about before concluding this class, I just want to give you idea about the rapid method of detection of total microbial load. What are those methods? Now, under methods of determination of colony forming unit, plate loop method, Rawl tube method, Kalworth Doppler technique, Petri film method, laser or image analyzer for colony counting, spiral plate makers, use of dehydrated nutrient pads, dip slide method. These all are methods for determination of colony forming units. So you have to remember the name of all these methods. Now, wholesale or micro colonies by microscopy. How you can go for this microscopy technique? Direct microscopy count is there, best breed smear method is there, then direct epifluorescent filtration technique is DEFT method is there, back to scan. These are all our rapid method for detection of microorganisms. Then hydrophobic grid membrane filtration technique is there, particle counting example, Carter and Remus or Orbic method is there. Flow cytometry is also very important, and these are the recent advancement in the field of dairy microbiology or food microbiology. There are some indirect method just by getting idea about different kind of metabolites or some kind of changes observed during the in different kind of media, you can have idea about the total bacterial load of that particular food item, in a particular type of food item. Turbidity, metabolic activity, dye reduction test, electrical methods, microcalorimetry, radiometry, and biosensor methods are there just by observing different kind of changes performed during the these methods. You can have idea about the total bacterial load. Then metabolic intermediates or byproduct, pyruvate or lactase, lactate estimation, then catalase, ATP estimation. So these are the methods generally performed by different laboratories to get idea about the total bacterial load or total microbial load of any food item. So it's very important to have idea about all these. In next class or next time, I will teach in detail about all these rapid method for detection of total microbial count. So this is all about